Good evening, everyone. Sorry about the delay. I'm glad that you can hear me. Sanjoy asked me to say a few things to begin with, just to get going in this discussion. First of all, just by way of introduction, my name is Charlie Cockell. I'm Professor of Astrobiology at the University of Edinburgh. And I've been here at Edinburgh for a couple of years, but I've been an astrobiologist for a long time. I first did a postdoc at NASA Ames Research Center back in the mid-1990s, seems a long time ago now, and that's when I really became, I guess, a bona fide astrobiologist. My PhD was in molecular biology, and it was only when I moved to the US that I really managed to bring my passion for space exploration together with my interest in biology and to become an astrobiologist. So I've been an astrobiologist since that time, and I can talk a bit more about my career if you're interested later. A typical day for us is looking at microbes in extreme environments. That's what we focus on, really microbiology. We're interested in trying to understand how microbes survive in rocks, in extreme rocky environments, how they get their energy and nutrients from rocks, and what the prospects for life are elsewhere on other planetary bodies. So on a day-to-day basis, what are the sort of things I do? Well, it's sort of split between a number of things, partly lab work. We do a lot. We have microbiology labs here at Edinburgh where we look at microbes, their role in ion cycling and in other types of biogeochemistry. And so I spend some of my time in the lab, not as much as I would like to these days. I guess that just comes with being head of a research group. Otherwise, I spend time writing research proposals, sometimes writing papers, and of course, doing teaching as well. I teach an astrobiology course here at Edinburgh that's actually about to start in 2 weeks' time. And so there's teaching obligations here. So like any astrobiologist, it's a question of juggling different things from administration to science to doing teaching. And that's what makes up a typical day of my life. But the real driving interest of mine is, of course, the astrobiology, the science. And I'm fascinated in this area of science just because it asks such such major questions. Many areas of science ask very important questions, but what really interests me about astrobiology is the question of whether we are the only planet that can host life in the universe, or whether there might be other planets that have life as well. That's still an unanswered question, and for me at least, is one of the most interesting questions in science. And so that's one of the major questions that interests me. I think the second question I would say that is also something that drives my interest in astrobiology is, can we establish a permanent human presence beyond the Earth? Can we go out and explore space and eventually build permanent human settlements on the Moon, Mars, or anywhere else? And so this is also something that interests me, and I guess really motivates me to do astrobiology on a day-to-day basis, knowing that we're contributing to the possibility of human beings moving out beyond the Earth permanently. And we also do some work in that area as well. For example, we've isolated microbes that can survive in the extreme conditions of outer space. And by looking at those microbes and how they can survive in extreme space environments, we might learn something about the sorts of microbes that we could use to support human space exploration and settlement. So that in a nutshell is very quickly is my motivations for astrobiology and how I got into astrobiology and what a typical day is. But I would much prefer just to answer questions that people may have about astrobiology generally, my own interest in astrobiology, and also any career questions about astrobiology. So I guess just fire ahead with questions. What experiments have you done in space? Yeah, we've done experiments where we've launched pieces of rocks with natural communities to the International Space Station. The most recent experiment we had was a European experiment called the EXPOSE experiment, where we took pieces of rock from the south coast of England that have natural communities of microbes in them, and we launched them on the space shuttle to the International Space Station, and they were bolted onto the outside of the space station for a year and a half. And then when the rocks came back, we looked to see whether anything had survived. and to see whether anything could survive the extreme conditions of space for a year and a half, the extreme desiccation, ultraviolet radiation, and other environmental stresses. And that was how I got involved in space experiments. We have a new experiment that's flying at the end of 2015 called BioRock, which is an experiment to look and see how microbes interact with rocks in the space environment. It's essentially a biological mining experiment to see how we can optimize mining in space and how microbes can be grown in rocks, for example, planetary regolith, to extract useful elements for planetary bases. The next question is, what are the challenges that astrobiology has to overcome in order to generate new scientific instruments dedicated for exoplanets research? Well, I guess it really all comes back to microbiology. I mean, I would say that as a microbiologist, but I really think that's one of the core disciplines of astrobiology. You can't go and look for biosignatures of life on other planets without understanding what sort of biosignatures life produces on Earth. You can't look, for example, for gases in the atmospheres of other planets unless you know what sort of gases are produced by microbes and how much of particular gases are produced by microbes. So it really does come back to microbiology. So what is the essential challenge in looking for life on exoplanets? I would say a deeper understanding of how microbes manage to produce different types of gases, what those gases are, and how much, what is the concentration of those gases that can be built up in planetary atmospheres, and what can we expect to find in other planetary atmospheres. So I think it does come back to microbiology, and it does come back to understanding what sort of biosignatures microbes on the Earth produce and what that might tell us elsewhere. So the next question is, how did you utilize your background in molecular biology to answer questions in astrobiology? Well, my PhD was actually in medical molecular biology. I was looking at the proteins involved in breaking down blood clots. So it really had nothing to do with astrobiology at all. It sort of frustrated me because it was very focused on just lab work. And I wanted to get a field component into it that would allow me to link biology to interests in space exploration. So molecular biology led on to microbiology in the US when I moved to NASA Ames to do my postdoc. And that was how I transitioned into astrobiology. But I think molecular biology is always a good background just because ultimately all organisms live in extreme environments based on their genes and based on their adaptations. So understanding something about molecular biology, about physiology, about microbial adaptations to extremes is a really essential part of, I think, of astrobiology, understanding what the limits are of life on Earth and what that might tell us about the possibilities of life elsewhere. So like microbiology, I would say molecular biology is also a very powerful discipline when applied to understanding the limits of life and aiding us in the search for life elsewhere. So the next question I have here is from Rika. And she says, I think a lot of people in Sagan Group would be interested in learning about outreach efforts, especially the Astrobiology Summer Academy. So what motivated us to do this, and how do we organize it and get funding for it? We set up the UK Centre for Astrobiology here at Edinburgh 2 years ago. And the centre has a number of objectives, some of which are scientific objectives, trying to understand the limits of life on Earth and how life can survive in extreme environments. But another objective we have is also outreach, to use astrobiology as a tool for improving science education and science outreach. And we thought, how could we do that? How could we make an effective contribution to improving science education in schools across the UK using astrobiology? And the idea that we came up with was called the Astrobiology Summer Academy. And this is an idea where students would come to Edinburgh and stay here in residence for a week. And they would spend a different day, each day, doing a different subject. So, for example, in the first day, they would do biology. In the second day, they would do a day of geology. And the next day, a day of astronomy. And then at the end of that, they would go to a public place. In this case, this year, we went to the Royal Botanic Gardens and provide public lectures and outreach activities in astrobiology. So that was the idea. And this summer, we carried out our first pilot program for a week and it was hugely successful. We had an excellent week. We had 14 students from across Scotland and England came to Edinburgh to learn astrobiology. And at the end of that week, they went to the Royal Botanic Gardens in Edinburgh to present lectures and hands-on activities to the general public on astrobiology. So the Astrobiology Summer Academy is going to be repeated next year, and it's going to be expanded. We're going to have a week not just with high school students, but also a week with teachers. And during that week, the teachers are going to put together lesson plans for high schools in the US and the UK that can be used by teachers to improve astrobiology. So we're doing this as a collaborative venture between the UK Centre for Astrobiology and the NASA Astrobiology Institute. And we hope that the result will be a series of lesson plans that can be used in high school students anywhere in Europe or the US to teach astrobiology, in addition to continuing the week of high school interaction that we had this year as well. So the Astrobiology Summer Academy is funded from whoever will give us money. And we've gone to the UK Space Agency, the Royal Astronomical Society. We're currently trying to get the funding for next year. And we hope that beyond that, we'll get permanent funding from possibly the UK Space Agency, but other organizations as well, to carry on the Astrobiology Summer Academy. So if you know of any teachers or high school students that want to learn astrobiology, please put them in contact with us. The website is www.astrobiologyacademy.org. And you can get some more information on the Astrobiology Summer Academy there. So that's been a really good thing for us. It's been really exciting for us to get involved in outreach and to use the critical mass that we've got here in Edinburgh to improve astrobiology education. So thanks for that question, Rika, and I hope you're well. Rika was one of the people who came over to the Astrobiology Summer Academy and funded by NASA to help us do the teaching and do the astrobiology outreach over that 1 week of the academy. That was very successful. So the next question is, why didn't other nucleotide-based life take off? I'm not sure exactly what that question means. If it means why didn't life that doesn't have DNA take off, that's a difficult question to answer because we don't understand what the other possible architectures of life might be. All we know is that the entire tree of life has a common molecular biological architecture of DNA as the information storage system, RNA as the intermediate molecule that carries that information through to proteins, which are the final product of reading the genetic code. And that architecture, that dogma, as it's called, of molecular biology, DNA to RNA to protein, is universal throughout the entire tree of life. Why is it like that? We don't understand. Is it universal? Probably not. Some groups have already created alternative genetic information, DNA with different nucleotides in. So it does seem that you can create other types of biochemistry and that the architecture we have of four nucleotides in DNA as the code for DNA and the chemistry of those nucleotides does not have to be universal. And it suggests that the molecular biological machinery of life on Earth was locked into life in the earliest organisms on Earth and has since been carried through to all other life forms on the Earth. If there is other alternative life, maybe it just got outcompeted, or maybe the architecture we have on the Earth just happened to be the original architecture that got locked into terrestrial evolution. But that's an interesting question. Sanjoy asked me a question following on from that, going back to outreach. Tell us about your experience teaching the astrobiology course on Coursera. So for those of you who don't know what that question's about, Coursera is an online web-based teaching platform where you can do courses in almost anything from economics to astronomy to art to music. If you're interested, it's Coursera, Coursera.org. And you can find almost any type of course on that website. We were asked at the University of Edinburgh to put together some courses for Coursera a year and a half ago, and I was asked by the university to produce one on astrobiology, which I did. And we ran that course last year, and incidentally, it starts again in January. It attracted 16,500 students, and over 7,500 students finished the course. It's 32 lectures of about 15 minutes each, which we pre-recorded. And then during the course, we have discussion forums on all aspects of astrobiology. It was really good fun to teach it. And the standard of discussion on the Coursera website during the course was just fantastic. So if you want an introduction to astrobiology, or even if you're an astrobiologist and you want to get involved in discussions about other areas of astrobiology, then I'd really recommend that course. As I say, it starts again in January and you can sign up for free. It doesn't cost anything. So have a look at that. Next question is from Kamesh here. Two career questions. How did you use your biochemistry background to do a postdoc in NASA Ames? And I'm not sure what the second part of that question is, but I will answer that first question. How did I use my biochemistry background? Well, I sort of didn't really. I went and pestered people at NASA Ames. I was a year before the end of my PhD, and I went to a thing called the International Space University, which is run every summer for 10 weeks. It's like a summer school in space exploration. And I went there for 10 weeks, and I met various NASA people there, whom I made a connection with. And then when I came back to do my PhD, I literally bought a ticket to the US, and I went there for a week and gave lectures at NASA Ames and pestered everyone I met to give me a postdoc. And then I spent a year after that just continuously pestering these same people until someone gave me a postdoc, which they did. I ended up in Lynn Rothschild's lab looking at microbiology of microbial mats at high UV radiation. So there was no magic insider method of getting to NASA Ames. It was just a question of talking to people enough and persuading them to find a postdoc. And then eventually I moved there and I used my biochemistry background to get into microbiology and really to change my focus from biochemistry into more microbiology type areas. Question following up from here, how do you pick your teachers for the summer academy? Could we volunteer to teach and propose courses? Yeah, you could volunteer to come to the academy. As I say, the website is astrobiologyacademy.org, and you can express an interest on that website just by filling in the contact form. We will pick them just by a process of selection. It depends how many apply, but the idea is we'll end up with a pool of teachers who have applied, and we'll pick teachers who we feel could get the most out of learning about astrobiology, and also teachers who look like they have the greatest chance of taking astrobiology back to their students and implementing it. So we're keen to just get more than teachers. We really want teachers that are going to go back into schools and teach astrobiology so we can have a really positive and measurable impact. So if you know of any teachers, or if you're a teacher who's interested in learning astrobiology, please do go onto our website and express an interest, and we'll be in contact. So Sanjoy asks a question here. Astrobiology doesn't really have a home department at a university. Did it take time for your more traditional peers at Edinburgh to accept astrobiology in the curriculum? It always takes time to get people to accept astrobiology, and it's an ongoing thing. It never stops. It's true what you say, that very few traditional departments are set up for astrobiology. It's a strange area of science just because it cuts across this interface between physics, biology, geosciences, and even in some respects, there are philosophical aspects to it. So in that sense, I think it's not unusual for us at Edinburgh. I think it's true for everyone. It's always been quite difficult to find a place where it truly fits in. If you're in a physics department, you've got the biology and the geosciences that always makes it slightly disconnected. If you're in a geosciences department, the biology probably seems a bit alien, and the astronomy, and so on and so forth. So wherever you are, there are aspects of astrobiology that don't fit into traditional disciplines. How do you deal with that? I think like you deal with anything like that, which is just to continue to be positive about what you're doing and show and get results. And at the end of the day, scientific disciplines are not so important. What's important is that you're doing something productive and that you're answering questions of interest. And as long as you're doing that, I think any department can ultimately assimilate astrobiology. But it does take more work than other areas of science. You do have to make an effort to go and talk to people, to create connections with other departments and other disciplines to ensure you have those connections in a university. But I think it's a challenge, and it is always going to be a challenge for astrobiology, and in fact any area of science that's interdisciplinary. So where else in Europe is astrobiology being taught in the curriculum? It depends what you mean by curriculum. If you mean the high school curriculum, that's a good question. There is a very strong Nordic astrobiology network that is teaching astrobiology in Sweden, Norway, and they are setting up astrobiology summer schools for students to learn about astrobiology, and they also are getting involved in some teacher training. So there are other groups in Europe that are teaching astrobiology. I should also mention the European Astrobiology Network Association, or EANA, which is the main European astrobiology society, and that's pretty involved in teaching. They have an astrobiology lecture course called ABCNet, which is run out of the European Space Agency, and that's a series of lectures from people from different universities across Europe that happens. I think it starts in October or November time, but I'm not quite sure about that. But that's an opportunity to engage in astrobiology teaching. Sanjoy asked, would you be open to elementary and middle school teachers in the academy? Yes, absolutely. I think that's the case. We have mainly focused on secondary school teachers, but if there are even primary school teachers interested in coming to the academy, we'd consider that as well. The main criterion for selecting a teacher to the Astrobiology Summer Academy will simply be an enthusiasm to take astrobiology back into schools and use astrobiology as a very powerful interdisciplinary way to teach students about physics, astronomy, geosciences, biology. So as long as we've got teachers that really want to work hard to take astrobiology back into schools, then we'd be very enthusiastic to have them here. And of course, teachers that are willing to write lesson plans. So the next question is, could you talk a bit about the big questions you are working on with extremophiles and microbes? Well, that's a very good question. There's many big questions in extremophile microbiology and astrobiology. Let me just touch on a couple of those that I think are interesting. There's a number of things that we're doing here that we're interested in, but just to pick two questions out of many, one interesting thing is to try and figure out how microbes respond to multiple stresses, to multiple extremes. When you look at the literature, you find that most people focus on their pet extreme. People look at microbes at high temperatures, microbes at low temperatures, microbes under high pressures. But very few people look at the synergy between different extremes. For example, how do microbes adapt to high pressures and cold temperatures? Well, it turns out that some of the adaptations that microbes use for one extreme can also be used in another extreme. For example, one of the problems that microbes have at low temperatures is membrane fluidity. The membranes tend to seize up. It's a bit like if you take a lump of butter and put it in your fridge, it becomes very solid. Well, the same thing happens with the fatty acids in cell membranes. When you put cells in a freezer, they start to solidify. So microbes have a problem with maintaining membrane fluidity at cold temperatures. So they introduce unsaturated fatty acids into their membranes, and that improves membrane fluidity. Well, it turns out that that's the same problem that microbes have under high pressures. Under very high pressures, the membranes tend to pack more solidly, and microbes have problems with membrane fluidity. So they do exactly the same thing. They introduce unsaturated fatty acids into their membranes to maintain fluidity. So here's an example of how adaptations to cold temperatures can be much the same as adaptations to high pressures. And we're interested in trying to understand how microbes can adapt to multiple extremes, because if you think about it, you can plot a three-dimensional space of life on Earth that is bounded by the extremes of different physical and chemical extremes. But that space may be very different when microbes are exposed to multiple stresses. And very few microbes in the natural environment are exposed to only one stress. Most microbes are exposed to many different types of stresses. So if we're truly to understand the boundaries of life on Earth and to be able to assess the possibility of life elsewhere, we need to try and understand the interaction of microbes with multiple extremes, environments that have multiple stresses. So that's one of the things that we're working on here. Another question that I think is very interesting is what sort of energy and nutrient supplies are available to life elsewhere in other environments? Trying to understand whether there are energy sources on places like Mars or in the Martian subsurface. So we're also doing experiments trying to understand how microbes might get access to different types of energy on other planets and how they might be able to sustain themselves in extreme environments. And that research can inform our understanding of how microbes get energy in extreme environments on the Earth. So those are just two examples of questions that I think are interesting in extremophile microbiology. But there are many other questions as well that we probably don't have time to talk about. The next question I have is what career paths have your students taken? They've gone off into all sorts of different directions. Some of my former students have gone off, for example, Aaron Gronstall went off and did outreach for NASA in astrobiology and getting involved in NASA outreach activities. Some of my students have continued on in research. It's also important to point out that astrobiology can take you in any direction. Once you've done astrobiology, you can get involved in anything from astronomy to environmental concerns. So some of my students and postdocs have gone off in non-astrobiology directions. I have a postdoc at the University of Lyon who left and got a lectureship at the University of Lyon, who's now doing bioremediation, improving heavy metal contaminated sites using microorganisms. So by studying life in extreme environments, we can also learn about how to decontaminate contaminated sites on the Earth. So these are the sorts of career directions that are also possible in astrobiology and some of the directions that my students have gone in. Svet asked me a question, are you involved with any missions or do you hope to be involved in missions? Yeah, we are involved in missions. We have our own space experiments. We're launching an experiment to the International Space Station that I mentioned earlier called BioRock to look at the interactions of microbes in rocks in microgravity environments. We're also involved in Mars missions, mainly through instrument teams. For example, I'm on the instrument team for the ExoMars Raman instrument and also for the Close-Up Imager, which is a microscope that's designed to go on the ExoMars rover being sent to Mars in 2018. Generally speaking, though, our focus is on lab-based and field-based microbiology, and where we can apply that to missions and to science and missions, we try and do so. As you can understand, missions are quite unpredictable and they don't happen very often, so we've never really focused our work just on missions. I've always thought that's a fairly precarious thing to do, given that missions don't happen very often, and even when they do happen, it's not you're not assured they're going to be successful. Things blow up on launch pads. So we try not to focus our whole research group on the success of missions, but get involved with them when we can and inform the science that's coming out of missions. What are some of the major challenges that you've encountered when teaching online? It's quite a difficult thing to teach online. I mean, even this discussion here is challenging just because you haven't got people in front of you. You can't see the facial expressions of people you're talking to. Are they bored? Are they excited? Are they understanding what I'm talking about? These are the sorts of things that are quite difficult to do when you're teaching online because you haven't got that interaction with your audience. You're just sitting in front of a computer talking at people. And so I think that teaching students in lecture theatres at university is a very beneficial way to improve online teaching because you can get a sense of what works and what doesn't. And certainly some of the astrobiology teaching that I've done online, I've tested during lectures to students that I've given at other universities. So I get an idea about what excites people, what doesn't, what's a good way to explain things, what isn't. And then I try and apply that in online teaching, and you just have to hope that the methods that you've chosen and the examples that you've chosen work with the audience. And you very quickly find out whether that's the case or not. Particularly during the Coursera course, we had a lot of feedback on the discussion forums, and that was quite useful for figuring out what was useful and what wasn't. So that was one way in which we managed to get feedback on the online teaching. But it is challenging. It's very different from teaching face-to-face, and it does take some practice to try and improve it and get it good. Next question is, what are your thoughts about the possibility of life in our solar system? You know, it sounds like a very uncommitted thing to say, but I find that question very difficult to answer, just because we don't know. There are places that are clearly you'd have greater optimism than other places in terms of looking for life. I personally think that Enceladus is one of the most exciting places to look for life at the current time, just because we know that there is liquid water or water being ejected from the interior of Enceladus, and we also know there's organics in the plumes of Enceladus. And both of those things are not yet determined for Mars. We don't know for certain whether there's liquid water on the surface or in the subsurface of Mars, and we still don't know where the organics are on Mars. Those are two crucial things for life, organic building blocks and liquid water. And yet, despite the excitement for Mars, we still don't know whether those two things are there. But we do know that they exist on Enceladus because the plumes have been sampled by the Cassini spacecraft. So what are my thoughts? My thoughts are that Enceladus still remains the most exciting place to go and also the easiest place to sample. We just have to fly through the plumes and collect samples. So I would go to Enceladus first and then probably Mars as a follow-up priority. Katie asks, how will we know what to look for? Well, that's also a very good question. I think that you have to base what you look for based on what we know about life on Earth. It's the only way to approach it because that's the one example of life that we have. I think what you're looking for is complex chains of molecules. Whenever you look at life on Earth, what you see is chains of things, whether that's DNA, which is a long chain, proteins that are a long chain, lipids that are a long chain. Life tends to build chains of things, and I think what you're looking for is complex organic molecules that do not look like they could be created by non-biological processes. So I think that would be the way to look for life, to look for complex chained molecules. Of course, you can get chains of molecules by non-biological processes. Carbon compounds, polyaromatic hydrocarbons, which are highly complex organic carbon compounds, which you can find in the interstellar medium, are examples of ring structures that are very complex, but they're non-biological. So one would have to look at the isotopic composition as well, and also the nature of these chains to try and determine whether they were biological. Jane asks, if you could have one instrument in situ anywhere in the solar system sending you back data right now, what would it be and where would you put it? Well, that's a very good question, Jane. I think, first of all, you want to find an environment that looks like it's habitable. And as I say, I think that the plumes of Enceladus I find particularly exciting. I think it would be a very challenging mission, but to have an instrument in situ in those plume areas, investigating the content of those plumes and their organic content, would obviously be one approach to looking for habitability and trying to search for life elsewhere. Perhaps another interesting place would be the putative brine seeps on Mars. If these seeps that people have investigated that seem to change seasonally on the surface of Mars really are liquid water, that would be a very exciting place to put an in-situ instrument to look at seasonal changes. If they're made of liquid water, what is their content and how does that liquid water change over seasonal timescales? So I think it would be very exciting to land an in-situ instrument in a brine seep on Mars, a putative brine seep. And if I was going to put an instrument there, I'd probably put a collection of instruments. Simple water detection instruments to measure the presence of liquid water, geochemical instrumentation to measure the chemical composition, and probably a GCMS to look and see whether there's any organics in those brine seeps. But anywhere where there's liquid water is a good place to put an in situ instrument over long time periods. And at the moment, those places are very few and far between in the solar system. Brine seeps on Mars, Europa possibly, but of course it's very difficult to get into the ocean, and there may not be any liquid water on the surface. The plumes of Enceladus, another interesting environment. So the next question is from Svet again about Raman, saying that she's also involved in some Raman instrumentation optimized for Mars. What kind of biosignatures is ExoMars's Raman instrument designed versus what is optimized? What is it optimized to find? Well, the Raman instrument is primarily optimized to look at minerals, just because we don't know whether we're going to find biosignatures. So it's designed as an instrument to look at core material collected by the ExoMars rover. So the ExoMars rover is designed to drill 2 meters into the surface of Mars and to collect subsurface samples. And the idea is that those samples will be brought to the surface. They'll be examined by XRD to look at their mineralogy, and Raman will also be used to look at the minerals. If there's any organic material in them, then of course Raman could try and find those organic signatures, particularly possibility of things like G and D bands that you find in heavily altered carbon could be investigated using Raman. So it'll look for mineral signatures and organic signatures. And our involvement in the instrument has been providing samples from field sites that can be used to try and optimize the Raman instrument, and also to see how effective it is at using, at looking for biosignatures, organic material in a rocky matrix. So the next question is from Kamesh. Which place do you think has a higher probability of conditions that can be likened to conditions in Europa? And then what is the higher probability for life? Well, no place on Earth is like an extraterrestrial environment. People talk about analog environments, and they use this phrase analog environments very loosely, but it's used too loosely, in the sense that some places on Earth have conditions that approximate to extraterrestrial environments, but there is no place on the Earth that is exactly like an extraterrestrial environment. And the reason for that is we've had at least 2 billion years of oxygen in the atmosphere and a hugely productive photosynthetic biosphere that's generated huge quantities of organic carbon and lots of oxygen in the atmosphere. And that has irreversibly changed the geochemistry, the biology, and even the geology of our planet. So anywhere where you go is really affected in some way by these huge geochemical alterations that have resulted from this oxygenated biosphere. So if you're going to find places that are like Europa, I think it's very difficult to find anywhere on the Earth that is exactly like Europa. But what you could do is ask questions like, what are the extremes of life in cold, salty environments? What might that tell us about the envelope of life and the energy that life needs to be able to live in cold, salty environments? And then you could start thinking about what that might tell us about Europa, if there is indeed a cold, salty ocean beneath the crust. And some of those cold, salty environments are found in the Arctic. There are cold, salty lakes and pond environments in the Antarctic that you can explore, Lake Vida, for instance, that can tell us something about Europa. So all of these places can tell us something about biology, how it survives, in particular physical extremes, that then allows us to improve our assessment of extraterrestrial environments. And that's the way in which you approach analog research. You find places that will tell you certain things about extraterrestrial environments, but there's nowhere on Earth that is exactly like Europa. Well, partly because we don't even know what the ocean of Europa, the composition of the ocean of Europa is at the moment. We can only take guesses, and presumably that information will improve over time with future missions. So we're still sort of guessing at what that ocean is like. But nevertheless, as I say, we can still go to extreme environments on the Earth and learn something about possible physical extremes. So the next question is from Gavril, who asks, what is your opinion for microbial life inside Martian caves? Well, that's an interesting question. We know there are caves on Mars. There's satellite evidence for the openings of caves on Mars. There's been some speculation about ancient ice inside those caves, and some speculation about the possibility that the interior of Martian caves might be a good place to escape the damaging effects of ionizing radiation. If you go about 2 or 3 meters beneath the surface of Mars, the ionizing radiation drops by about 2 orders of magnitude. So a cave several hundred meters into the subsurface is a very good place to escape ionizing radiation. So these could be places to look for life. Would they contain microbial life? Well, it depends whether there's liquid water. Another good thing about a cave is that it takes you beneath the surface of Mars where the pressure is slightly higher. And if the pressure is higher, then you're above the triple point of water and you've got a possibility of liquid water. There's no possibility of liquid water on the surface of most of Mars today because it's at the triple point where water just sublimates from solid to vapor. The problem is, even if the pressure is high enough to get to theoretically get liquid water beneath the surface of Mars, is the temperature ever high enough to warm ice to turn into liquid water? So you need both high pressure and higher temperatures to get liquid water. So the problem with caves is that the pressure might be right, but the temperature might be still too low for liquid water to form. So it's difficult to know whether cold subsurface Martian caves would be a good place for life. Having said that, there might be a good place to look for evidence of preserved life. Ancient ice on Mars that may have been frozen at a time when there was liquid water abundant on the surface of Mars during the Noachian, greater than 3.5 billion years ago. If any of that liquid water has frozen and is present in the interior of Martian caves today, this could be a good place to look for biosignatures. So Martian caves, yes, definitely an interesting places to go and look. Sanjoy asked me, could you describe to us some of the field work you've been involved with and what exciting places you get to as an astrobiologist? Yeah, that's it's a good question. And I guess that's one of the things that is exciting about astrobiology is that to collect microbes in extreme environments, we have to go to, we're forced to go to these very extreme places. And places I've been to have included the Antarctic. I used to work for the British Antarctic Survey. I worked for them for 4 years. I've been to the Arctic, to the Horton Impact Crater, to study life in asteroid craters. I've been to the Atacama Desert in Chile to look at the effects of high ultraviolet radiation on life and to try and understand how it can survive in extremely desiccated environments with high UV radiation. I've been to Iceland to look at life in volcanic environments. And to try and understand how life makes a living in basalts and other newly formed volcanic environments. And I've also been to places to look at life in impact craters elsewhere. I've been to South Africa and looked at life in some of the asteroid craters there. It's a beautiful 1 kilometer diameter impact crater in South Africa that is worth visiting. So. Asteroid craters, volcanic environments, and polar environments have really been the three things that have taken me to different field sites around the world. And my students have been to very interesting places as well. A group of them just have come back from Disco Island in Greenland, collecting rocks and looking at life in an extreme environment in Greenland where the basalt rocks, the volcanic rocks, are much like volcanic rocks on Mars. So these are the sorts of places I go to. They're usually cold, they're usually extreme, but they're always very interesting. And astrobiology is one area of science that certainly has this very strong field component. So Kenda has a question here, and she's asking, do you think we are ready to move forward with human-driven astrobiology missions versus robotic missions? Yeah, I think that we are. I think that the human exploration of Mars is long overdue. And I think there's two reasons for this. First of all, humans are the best robots that we have. If you want to explore another planetary environment, you can't do better than to send a human robot to explore those environments. Human robots have some downsides. You have to provide them with food and habitats, and you have to shield them from radiation. But as a robot, the human brain has extraordinary powers of pattern recognition. It can do things that would take mechanical robots years to do. The rate at which you can do science is vastly greater than mechanical robots. So humans are the most powerful robots we have, and we should send them to other planets to do our exploration. a question, I think, a pertinent question is, if we do build robots that are as good as humans, then should we just drop human exploration altogether? I think this is where the second part of human exploration comes into the equation. It's not just the science we can do, it's also about what the long-term objective of our species is. And what we think the long-term objective of our civilization is. And I personally believe that one of our long-term objectives should be to move out beyond the Earth and settle space. I think that if you're a species that's just going to sit on a planet and do nothing else and not move out beyond your planet of origin, that's a rather dismal and unambitious objective for a civilization to decide to take. So part of sending humans to other planets is science and the extraordinary capabilities of humans to do exploration. Part of it is the long-term objective of our civilization. So even if robots eventually become as good as humans, mechanical robots become as good as the human robot, there's still a reason for us to go into space and explore and settle other planets. So yes, I think we've always been ready for human exploration, and the sooner it happens, the better. And hopefully commercial spaceflight will accelerate the rate of human space exploration. I'm then asked the question, are you currently serving as president of the Association of Mars Explorers, which you co-founded in 2002? Yes, I am. The Association of Mars Explorers was founded in a pub in California in 2002 when I was in the US. I got together 15 of my friends in the US. We went to a pub and we signed a declaration of the Association of Mars Explorers. As we were signing that declaration, Barry Bloomberg, who sadly has passed away but was previously director of the NASA Astrobiology Institute and a Nobel Prize winner for discovering and finding a cure for the hepatitis virus, walked into the pub and signed the declaration as well. So we founded an association that had a Nobel Prize winner on it, and it's been running now for 11 years. And you can sign up to join the Association of Mars Explorers. We have a Facebook page. You can sign up there and you can contact us through that Facebook page. We have a dinner once every 2 years, and the next dinner is scheduled for next year, probably at the Astrobiology Science Conference. And I really recommend that if you do analog research, please join the association. It's a lot of fun. I have to say we don't do a lot because we haven't got to Mars yet. But we have a dinner once every 2 years, and it's also a very good forum for bringing people together to talk about Mars analog research and share their ideas and their experiences. We really want to improve the website, the Facebook group that we have, and use that as a forum for disseminating information on analog field sites. So please join up. It's a fun association. It's free. And you can come along to the dinner if you're at the next Astrobiology conference. If you're interested, you can also join the board of directors. We're always looking for new people to bring new ideas onto our association. So please get involved. Katie, what would you say is the human importance of astrobiology? Is there a deeper meaning to our search? Yeah, I think there is. I think the deeper meaning is, what are we doing on this planet, and what is our long-term objective, and is there anyone else out there? These are really fundamental questions in astrobiology. Are we alone in the universe? One of the most ancient questions that humans have asked. Astrobiology has many questions, and I think it's important not just to get focused on the question of, is there life elsewhere? Questions like, what are the limits of life on Earth? What is the impact of human industry and human civilization on life on Earth? These are all interesting questions and important questions that astrobiology can answer. But nevertheless, at the core of all that, there remains this compelling question: are we alone in the universe? And there's no doubt that that's one of the most compelling questions in astrobiology. And the human aspect of that comes from the fact that that question has huge implications for us. If there's no other life in the rest of the universe, then what does that mean about us? What does it mean about our decisions on what our long-term objectives are? Why have we spent the last 40,000 years building a civilization? Is it just so that we can sit on a planet and be lonely in greater luxury? What are we going to do with ourselves for the next several million years if there's no one else to talk to in the rest of the universe? These are very cogent questions, and they're very interesting questions. and they have a huge impact on our civilization and what we decide our long-term objectives are, and therefore how we go about doing those long-term objectives. If we don't think it's worth exploring the rest of the universe and settling the rest of the universe, then maybe we should just shut down all space exploration and just sit on the Earth and wait for an asteroid impact to make us extinct. That's a possible long-term objective. We could decide to do that, and it would be a perfectly rational thing to do. But is it what we want to do? Well, astrobiology, I think, has a lot to contribute in answering those sorts of questions. What are our long-term objectives of a civilization, and how do we go about implementing those objectives and answering the questions that underpin our long-term goals? So yeah, there's a very, very strong connection between the human journey and the future of civilization and this particular science. Sanjo says we're getting close to time. Any last few questions for Dr. Cockell? Okay, let me see what we've got here. A few words of wisdom for students. Yeah, let me give a couple of words of wisdom. You'll find as you go into astrobiology, the people wonder what it's about. It's very interdisciplinary. It doesn't seem to fit in any particular discipline. It also asks some pretty crazy questions. Is there any life out there in the universe? Let's face it, that's a fascinating question, but most people wonder why you would be doing that from 9 to 5 as a job. My advice is to maintain an interest in this science, continue to create lots of links with friends and colleagues. The best way to get on in science is to have a network of friends in different disciplines who can help you out when you need help. Always make connections in different disciplines if you're interested in astrobiology. If you find it difficult to be in a particular place because you don't seem to fit into a particular discipline, realize that that's not unusual. Lots of people have that problem, not just astrobiologists, but many other scientists. Just continue to maintain connections with other people in different disciplines. And above all, like any science, just maintain enthusiasm. Enthusiasm goes a long way in science, being interested in what you're doing. Finding the questions compelling is really what drives science, and above all makes science fun. You know, I always say that we don't get paid enough to do bad politics in science. Science should be fun. So just enjoy astrobiology and work with people who have a similar level of enthusiasm and enjoyment as you, and you'll find this field continuously fascinating, continuously throwing up interesting questions. And remember that the missions that are happening in the next few decades will be some of the most interesting missions in astrobiology. The golden age of astrobiology has yet to happen, and it will happen in the next few decades. So stick with this area of science, and I think it's going to be a great few decades ahead. And then the last question, human beings are going to take microbes with them. That's true. Okay, it sounds like we've come to an end. I should stop there. Sanjoy is thanking me for time on SAGAN. Thank you, everyone. Please drop emails to me if you've got any questions. Make contact on Facebook, and let's all stay in touch in the future. And thanks a lot for taking your time.